Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. In this session, we are going to discuss about the scheme of community development through polytechnics. Now, before I come to the scheme of community development through polytechnics, I would like to give you a little background. It was way back in 1978-79, Government of India, Ministry of HRD decided to start a scheme called Community Polytechnic. And the basic objective of that community polytechnic scheme was to make the benefit of science and technology reach to the intended target groups. And intended target groups at that time included basically the rural people, rural youth, both male and female, then scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, economically weaker sections of the society, disabled person, and other disadvantaged group. So, this scheme to start with, it was started in 12 polytechnics. After a year or so, it got extended to 36 polytechnic, and thereafter in a phased manner, by the year 2001-2002, the scheme was operational in almost 670 polytechnics. Now, the scheme was running reasonably well, and a network of 670 polytechnics. Thereafter, each polytechnic having 5 to 6 extension center. So, there were almost 3000 locations all over the country. And you can well imagine when you have such a large scheme operational in the country, there would be variety of problems. So, there were some problems. People who had worked in the scheme for about 15 to 20 years, many of them they started asking for regularization. Many of them they started asking for higher wages. There were many litigations, and ultimately it so happened because of the kind of problems which that scheme was faced with. So, this scheme was finally withdrawn by Government of India way back in October 2007. Now, when the scheme got withdrawn, so naturally people who were the beneficiaries or potential beneficiaries, so they started feeling perturbed, and they started approaching their elected representatives, they started approaching principals of the polytechnics, they even started writing to Ministry of HRD, Government of India, and they were all aiming at getting the closed scheme started once again. But in government system, when a scheme is withdrawn, so naturally that scheme was withdrawn after a lot of thinking. So, that scheme was not to be started, but thereafter when there was little bit of pressure from the public at large and people from the country, they wanted similar scheme to be started again. So, keeping this requirement in view, Government of India conceived the idea of starting another scheme called Community Development through Polytechnics. So, this scheme to my mind is a scheme which has been built up based on the experiences of running the earlier scheme, and it had almost the similar objectives as compared to the earlier community polytechnic scheme. So, the scheme was started way back in year 2009 and 2010. In fact, this scheme was inaugurated by the then Honorable Minister of HRD, Government of India, Shri Arjun Singh Ji. The scheme was announced from the holy place of Tirupati. So, in this session, we are going to discuss about what this scheme is all about, how is it being operated, who are the intended target groups, how does the scheme get conducted at the polytechnic level, how is it monitored at the district level, then at state level, and finally at national level, and what are the kind of advantages which accrue to the public at large. So, this is what we are going to discuss in this session. So, as I have already mentioned, the scheme commenced from year 2009-2010. To start with, this scheme was aiming at covering almost 1000 polytechnics. So, the scheme was to be started in 1000 polytechnic, of course, in a phased manner. Then, having announced the scheme during the year 2009 itself, Government of India had identified 700 polytechnics. In fact, these 700 polytechnics already stand identified. Most of them, they are already offering the scheme, and the programs and activity under the schemes are being conducted. Some 300 more polytechnics are going to be covered under this scheme, and maybe in a year or so. So, 300 polytechnic in a phased manner, they are going to be added to the fold of this scheme. Now, it is such a wonderful scheme. This scheme covers all 35 states and union territories. In our country, we have 28 states and 7 union territory. So, the scheme has its presence in all states and union territories. Now, I would like to share with you the major objectives of this scheme. I told you the objectives of the earlier community polytechnic scheme. So, when it came to deciding about the objective of this scheme, by and large the objectives were decided keeping in view the objective of the earlier scheme. So, this scheme was started to ensure fair share of benefits from investment in technical education to scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, other backward classes, women, school dropouts, minorities, physically disabled, economically weaker sections of the society and other underprivileged persons by imparting non-formal training, technology transfer and by providing technical and support services to these intended target groups. So, these were the objectives basically. Now, there are specified activities under this scheme. The first activity under this scheme is conducting need assessment survey. As I told you, this scheme is operational almost all throughout the country. So, there are specified activities which need to be carried out. So, whatever activities, whatever programs and activities have to be carried out under the scheme, they are all required to be based on the findings of this need assessment survey. By way of conducting need assessment survey, we come to know about the local requirements, we come to know about the profile of the people around, the kind of skill training required, and then accordingly programs and activities are planned under the scheme. The second activity under the scheme is organizing skill development training program. In fact, under this scheme, we are aiming at imparting skills to the intended target groups, and the kind of skill program required to be offered, they are all dependent upon the findings of the need assessment survey. Then the third activity under the scheme is popularizing dissemination and appropriate technologies. Now, because this scheme is largely meant for the rural people and the downtrodden, so what happens many a times, people in rural area, they also buy high tech equipments as people buy in you know, urban areas. But what happens is, many a time these equipment they go out of order, and then thereafter these people, they are unable to get them repaired simply for want of non-availability of technical manpower in villages. So, with a view to provide them technical and support services, so under this scheme we have a provision of providing technical and support services to the rural people, as well as we have provision of disseminating and popularizing appropriate technology. And finally, we have fifth activity under the scheme, and this activity is known as organizing awareness programs. Now, awareness programs are organized under the scheme by almost all polytechnics, and these awareness programs are largely, you know, based on the local needs or something, you know, any problem being faced by the society or an issue which need to be popularized in the society. So, accordingly the awareness programs are conducted. Like, it could be a program pertaining to prevention of malaria, or something to do with AIDS awareness, something to do with say value education, something to do with health of the people, or it could be something to do with say organic farming or popularizing vermicomposting. So, that kind of issues. So, these are five major activities under the scheme. Then, as regards target group, the scheme is targeted to benefit the poorer sections of the society. The scheme is basically for the downtrodden, people who are not really that well off. So it will cover basically the poorer sections of the society, in particular scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, other backward classes, women, school dropouts, minorities, physically disabled, economically weaker sections of the society, and other underprivileged persons. So these are the intended target groups. Now any scheme would definitely have physical targets and financial targets under it. So under the scheme of community development through polytechnics, we have physical targets, and these physical targets are defined in terms of what we expect from the scheme. So first of all, we have physical targets with regard to need assessment survey. As I told you, there are 5 major activities under the scheme. So for each activity, there are targets given under the scheme. So under need assessment survey, each selected polytechnic is required to conduct need assessment survey of 10 to 20 villages every year. And here the idea is, like, let's assume there are 2 or 3 polytechnic operational in a particular district. So on an average, there are 1000 villages in one district. So if there are 3 polytechnics, so each polytechnic will have or will cater to geographical area of almost 300 villages. So here the idea is, when we talk about need assessment survey, each polytechnic is now expected to conduct need assessment survey of 5 to 10 villages, ultimately aiming at that in a phased manner, slowly and slowly, over a period of 4 to 5 years, all 300 villages, they should get covered. And the polytechnic is expected to have fairly good idea about the total resources available, manpower available, forest resources, agriculture resources, mineral resources, the kind of skills required in that area. So it's basically stock taking and finding out the ground realities of that place. So that's what we do under the need assessment survey. Then data available. When we talk about the need assessment survey, it's not that every data has to be necessarily collected by the polytechnic. In fact, they can largely depend upon the data which is already available, and the data available from banks, credit plans. In every district there are large number of banks, and one of the bank is declared as the lead bank. So usually this lead bank comes out with a credit plan. So we expect that polytechnic, they should have access to credit plan proposals, then surveys conducted by Department of Economics and Statistics. There is a Department of Economics and Statistics in every state, and this department brings out lot of valuable data. So polytechnic are expected to make use of that data, and then the surveys conducted by NGOs, non-governmental organizations, and data available from census reports. So we expect polytechnic to make use of this secondary data which is already available in the form of print material, and then polytechnic can also conduct surveys on its own, and then the idea is to clearly identify the kind of activities or the kind of skill development programs which can be carried out within the vicinity of the polytechnic. Then we come to the second activity, that pertains to skill development training program. Each selected polytechnic is required to conduct need based skill development training program on an average for 600 persons in a year. Now 600 persons are to be trained by each polytechnic. Usually we expect each polytechnic to organize 20 programs with an intake of 30 students each. So that works out to 600, but then when you start offering such programs, so at times the number of students that tend to go up, at time it comes down, but on an average we expect 600 people, they should get trained over a period of 1 year by one polytechnic. As regards application of appropriate technology, each selected polytechnic is required to organize minimum 5 technology demonstration event every year. And when they organize such like event, technology demonstration event, we expect a participation of at least 50% when a particular technology is demonstrated. And if it is that, so 5 technology demonstration event multiplied by 50 beneficiaries. So, at least 250 persons must get benefit of technology demonstration or technology dissemination with the help of one polytechnic in a year. So, these are the targets for popularization of appropriate technologies. Now, coming to technical and support services, here again there are almost similar kind of targets as we mentioned in case of technology popularization, and each selected polytechnic is required to organize minimum 5 technical and support services camp per annum. These camp could be organized at an interval of maybe 2 to 3 months, and they do not have to necessarily organize such like camps at the main campus of the polytechnic. These camps can be organized even at the extension centers. I will tell you about the concept of extension center little later. Then, as regards awareness generation, each polytechnic shall generate awareness about issues of importance of to the society. So, these issues of importance, I cited some examples earlier. Any issue which you feel is of importance to the society, like earlier I gave you example of eradicating malaria or value education or something to do with health or this misuse of drugs. Okay. So, all such like issues, they are considered to be issues of importance to the society at large, and awareness camps can be organized pertaining to such like activities. Now, we expect polytechnics to organize annual community mela at least one per year, and when this annual community mela gets organized, we expect polytechnic to invite their pass out their beneficiaries or potential user of this scheme. We expect them to invite people from panchayat, people from block development office, or they can invite other people who are interested in the activities and programs of this scheme. Then awareness through mass media, that also is insisted upon, and we expect polytechnic to generate awareness about the scheme, about its activity, about its benefit by way of making use of mass media. We also suggest polytechnics to deliver talk by way of making use of radio, television, FM channel. So, maybe seasoned people from polytechnic, either principal or some other senior heads of the department, they can go and they can deliver talks about the achievement of the scheme or something which is intended under the scheme. So, this can be shared, and this mass media and radio, TV, etcetera, they can be made use of. We also expect polytechnics to organize exhibitions pertaining to activities and programs under the scheme. These exhibitions could be sponsored by some industry, they could be sponsored by Department of Science and Technology or by any other government department or even by non-governmental organizations. Then lastly, releasing advertisement in local newspapers, and we expect each polytechnic to release program related advertisement at least twice in a year. They could be given at an interval of 6 months each. Now, we move on to the concept of extension center. This scheme is to be implemented at the main center, that is nothing but polytechnic campus, and also the scheme can be offered or programs and activities can be started at extension center. Here we expect that each polytechnic should establish at least 5 to 10 extension center, minimum is 5, and there is a maximum provision of 10 extension center. And this scheme is being dynamic in nature. In fact, what we expect, that rather than beneficiaries coming to the institution, institutions should try to go to the doorstep of the needy people. That is the concept, and that is why this concept of starting extension center. Each extension center to cover a cluster of 10 to 20 villages, because there should not be long distances involved. When we organize a particular program at an extension center, so it is only young people from nearby villages, they should come, and not many expenses should get involved in it. So, each extension center that way need to cater to a cluster of 10 to 20 villages. Okay, as regards setting up of extension center, we expect Polytechnic to start extension centers with the help of NGOs at their premises. Extension centers can also be started at ITIs, schools, village panchayat samitis, vocational schools, and other convenient places. Now, participating polytechnics to explore possibilities of getting rent-free accommodation for extension center. Now, there was a time when polytechnics used to get rent-free accommodation either in ITI or in some other place or even by village panchayats, but now people have become little more commercial, people have become materialistic and they expect rent for whatever premises they give it give for this activity. So, if it is that, then there is a provision under the scheme. In case there are no rent free accommodation available, then scheme permits premises can be hired and accordingly extension center can be set up. In case there is no place available at an extension center, then even a low cost temporary shed can also be constructed, and for that there is a provision in the scheme, whatever expenses get involved in it, so they are reimbursable from the scheme. Extension centers need to be used as training center as well as service center. So, at an extension center, it is largely set up for imparting training, but at that very place a camp can be organized or services can be provided, technical and support services can be provided from that very extension center. Extension centers need to be shifted from one place to another. Now, the concept of extension center is to cover the entire district within the vicinity of the polytechnic, and for doing so naturally the extension center set up at a particular place. So, having met the need of that place, then the polytechnic need to wind up that extension center and have the similar facility at some other cluster of villages, so that in a phased manner over a period of time the entire district gets served. That is the idea. The scheme lays emphasis on engaging local trainer. Under this scheme, when it comes to imparting skill training, so it is no point having a trainer from a far off place. Now, if you engage a trainer from a far off place, then naturally this person has to commute and lot of money gets involved in travelling and all, and the person won't be in a position to devote much time. So, here the idea is the polytechnic need to identify an effective qualified trainer from the village itself within that cluster and pay them whatever honorarium is permissible under the scheme. So, engagement of local trainer is rather appreciated. The scheme lays emphasis on maximum use of facilities of ITIs, vocational school, vocational center, and facilities provided by the industry. So, whatever infrastructure or laboratory facility, workshop facilities are available with such like organizations, they can be used for the purpose of this scheme. Now, we come to the duration of the training programs. Under this scheme, non-formal skill development programs are to be offered, and most of the skill training programs would be of a duration of 6 weeks, but at times there could be program which can be completed in less than 6 months, or at times there may be program which cannot be completed in 6 months also. So, there is a bit of flexibility inbuilt in the scheme. We usually emphasize on this thing, most of the program they should be of 6 month duration. In exceptional cases, some of the program could be of lesser duration, but in no case less than 3 months in duration. At the same time, some of the program could go beyond 6 months, but that again is an exception. By and large, the program should get concluded usually within 6 months. Then, now we come to the monitoring of this scheme. This scheme is monitored at number of levels. The scheme gets monitored at the polytechnic level, it gets monitored at the district level, thereafter at state level, and finally at the national level. Now, as regards this monitoring of the scheme at polytechnic level is concerned, we have an executive committee and as advisory committee in place. So, there is a document pertaining to this scheme. Here is the document. this is the guideline document for implementation of this scheme. So this document contains all details, all operational aspects as to how you should go about advertising the scheme, how you can be selected, what all norms and guidelines you got to follow. So under this scheme, even the constitution of this thing, executive committee and advisory committee, constitution of these two committees is given in this booklet, and Polytechnic can make use of that information. They can constitute advisory committee and executive committee for the purpose of planning, monitoring and evaluating the effect of this scheme. Then when it comes to monitoring the scheme at district level, here maybe we can assume there are more than one polytechnic operational in a particular district, then district administration can monitor the scheme at district level, and there again the role of advisory committee, which would exist in every polytechnic. So the role of advisory committee is very important. With the help of advisory committees of different polytechnic, district administration can easily monitor the scheme. Then at third level, we have a mechanism of monitoring the scheme at state level. There is a state level review committee in place, and constitution of that state level review committee is again given in booklet which I just showed you. So director of the technical education from each state, this state level review committee is chaired by the director, and other members, they are mentioned in the booklet. So we expect that director should convene meeting of the state level review committee at least twice in a year at an interval of 6 months or so, and with the help of state level review committee, the progress of the scheme can be monitored. Then at regional level, the four NITERs, like we have NITER at Chandigarh, there are three other NITERs, one each at Chennai, Kolkata and Bhopal, and that's how the entire country is covered. So at regional level, NITERs with the help of Directorate of Technical Education, so they keep on monitoring the scheme, and usually once in a year we have a national level review of the scheme, national level monitoring of the scheme, and this review is usually taken by the Secretary to Government of India in the Department of Human Resource Development. So Secretary, Additional Secretary and other people who are in charge of the scheme, they are all present. All four NITERs are invited, and we got to make presentation about the progress made under the scheme. That's how the scheme gets monitored at the national level. And in light of the experience gained, or in light of the program problems faced, so at times ministry also gives additional directions which are later on conveyed to the polytechnic system. As regards eligibility to participate in the CDTP scheme, it's a scheme which is basically to be implemented by the polytechnics. But the conditions for participating in this scheme are, any institution which is of diploma level, and the institution should be offering at least one diploma program, at least one diploma program. There could be more than one, okay? So any institution which has been in existence for the past 3 years and offers at least one diploma level program, so that institution is eligible to apply for this scheme. And when the institution finds itself eligible for participating in the scheme, then they are required to submit, they are required to prepare their proposal and then submit it to the concerned agencies. So proposals, when invited by the MHRD Government of India, they are required to be submitted to MHRD GOI or Directorate of Technical Education, or proposal can also be submitted to the concerned NITER. And these proposals, they have to be submitted on the prescribed format. These formats are available. They are available on our website. They are also available on ministry's website. A committee for identification of polytechnics. There is a committee in place, a committee appointed by Ministry of HRD, Government of India. So this committee meets. They will then scrutinize all the proposals, and they will take the decision whether the whether a particular institution should be inducted into the scheme or not. Then this scheme cannot cannot be run successfully without the commitment from the state government or union territory administration. There are lot many clearances required, both from the state government as well as union territory administration. Like for starting this scheme, full support of the state government and union territory administration is required. First of all, any participating institution, particularly those which are in government sector or in aided sector, so they need permission from the state government for making application for the scheme. This is the very first hurdle which they have to overcome, and they need approval from the state government. Then secondly, opening bank account as per MHRD's instructions. Under this scheme, money flows in the form of one-time non-recurring grant and then recurring grant. As per instructions from the Ministry of HRD, so two separate bank accounts need to be opened. So for opening any bank account, government institutions do need permission from the state Directorate of Technical Education. Then constituting committee for operationalizing the scheme. As I mentioned earlier, so there are number of committees which need to be constituted for operationalizing the scheme. Like at polytechnic level, one need to constitute executive committee and advisory committee. So for constituting these two committees, so permission is required from the directorate. Then a number of equipments, they have to be purchased. Some asset creation takes place. So when it comes to making purchases or creating assets, so there again state government permission is required. Their full cooperation is needed for making this scheme successful. Then making payment of honorarium to functionaries of this scheme. Now under this scheme, there are some people who are going to be involved from within the polytechnic, and there are others who are going to be taken on contractual basis. Now if some honorarium is to be paid to the polytechnic faculty or staff, so again permission of the state government is required. Then appointment of project staff is something which is very, very crucial. No project staff can be appointed in polytechnic without the permission of the state government. So for appointing project staff, polytechnic needs permission from the state government. And then monitoring of the scheme at district level and at state level, that again is to be done by the state government. And lastly, permitting project staff to attend workshop, training programs, seminars and review meetings from time to time. So the project staff, they have to be trained. They need inputs pertaining to different skill programs. Usually such like programs are organized at NIT or Chandigarh. And then naturally, if they have to attend such programs, so the project staff would need permission of the state government. Of course, it is routed through the principal of the concerned polytechnic. And similarly, in a year, we hold two review workshop, half yearly review workshop, usually in the month of September, and then year end review workshop sometime in the month of March. So in these review workshop, we expect principal and the main coordinator in each polytechnic to attend these workshop. There again, they require permission of the state government. Now we move to annual operation plan. Now such a vast scheme operational in hundreds of polytechnics, and then hundreds of polytechnic having thousands of extension center. So naturally their activities got to be planned well in advance. So for helping polytechnic in planning their activity, we expect each polytechnic to prepare annual operational plan. This annual operational plan is usually prepared in the month of March, and then it comes to NITER. So we appraise that operation plan. In case there are deficiencies, so we identify the deficiency, we convey it to the polytechnics, then changes are accordingly made, and finally the operation plan is approved. So each polytechnic prepares an operation plan on the prescribed format. This format is given by NITER Chandigarh, and after preparing this operation plan, it is submitted to us. Then summary of the operation plan, so that usually make it available to the Ministry of HRD, Government of India. So once the operation plan is prepared, it is approved, thereafter polytechnic can start conducting the programs and activities. Now in this scheme, we try to involve the entire polytechnic. not that we are not allowing them to take on their routine activities, but the idea is to spread the message and take the people along. From each polytechnic, it is either the principal or the director of that polytechnic who happens to be the chief coordinator. So, principal or director would be the chief coordinator, then one of the senior head of the department is going to be designated as internal coordinator. Then the scheme involves many other functionaries, and in polytechnic or in some bigger institution you will have positions like administrative officer, superintendent, deputy superintendent, accountant, cashier, storekeeper, instructors and helpers. These are the kind of people who are going to be involved in effective implementation of the scheme. So, polytechnic will identify such like staff and they are going to be associated with the implementation of the scheme. And because they are going to be associated with implementation of the scheme, so there is a provision of making some making payment of some honorarium to these project functionaries. I will come to that little later. Then when it comes to organizing annual community mela, so every identified polytechnic is expected to hold a yearly community mela at the main center or at one of the extension center. Okay. And in this community mela, usually trainees, then people who have already attended the program, then variety of stakeholders, officials of village panchayat and jila parishad, people from district rural development agencies, then officials from khadi and village industries commission, krishi vigyan kendras, non-governmental organizations, then ITIs, nearby schools and eminent persons, they are the one who need to be invited. The identified polytechnic through this community mela reflect their activities and programs and achievements made during the year under the scheme, they are also highlighted. This in turn creates, you know, awareness about the scheme or what all we are really aiming at achieving with the help of the scheme. This yearly mela is considered as one of the important activities under this scheme. So, organizing annual community mela that helps in spreading message about the scheme, its you know, this thing, spreading message about the achievements and also attracting participants in future. Now, we come to the financial. No scheme can run without finance. So, as I mentioned earlier, there used to be a scheme of community polytechnic which was operational for about 27-28 years. So, when that earlier scheme was operational, it took us little time in closing down that scheme, but there were lot many assets created under that scheme. When the scheme got withdrawn, so assets were not taken back by the government. So, those assets are still with those institutions. Now, the new scheme called CDTP scheme that has come, that has become operational. So, when it came to budgeting expenditure under this scheme, so we categorize the institutions in two categories. There are old institutions which were implementing the scheme, earlier scheme, and some of those old institutions, they were weeded out, either they were inefficient or they were not willing to carry on the activity, or some of the polytechnic they had got closed. So, there are old institutions which were implementing the other earlier scheme, and then there are new institutions which are getting into the new scheme for the first time. So, accordingly the budget has been sanctioned. Now, the money in the scheme flows in the form of non-recurring grant and also in the form of recurring grant. Now, when it comes to old institutions, so old institutions are going to be given one-time non-recurring grant of 13 lakh, and this will help polytechnics in creating assets or making purchases, then building up infrastructure for providing training. But when it comes to new institutions are given more money because they didn't have any asset base particularly for this scheme. So, whereas an existing institution gets 13 lakh, the new institution will get non-recurring grant of 20 lakh. As regards recurring grant, so there is no difference in new institution and old institutions, both get recurring grant at the rate of 17 lakh rupees per annum. Now, we will discuss financial norms and guidelines, the heads under which non-recurring grant is to be utilized. So, those heads are explained here. Now, here again we are dividing the institutions in two categories: polytechnics, which did not receive non-recurring grant under erstwhile community polytechnic scheme, and then there are polytechnics which received non-recurring grant under erstwhile community polytechnic scheme. Okay. Now, the new institution joining the scheme for the first time, they are going to be provided a grant of non-recurring grant of 7 lakh rupees, and the old institution will receive 4,50,000. Now, there are bases for granting this money. As I mentioned earlier, a polytechnic can set up 5 to 10 extension center. So, here the budgetary provisions are for purchase of tools and equipment for 5 to 10 extension center, and budgeting is done keeping in view the maximum number of extension center. So, if there are 10 extension center, so we are providing 70,000 rupees for starting one extension center, and then naturally this works out to 7 lakh rupees. When it comes to old institution, they were allowed to start at the maximum 5 extension center. So, they already have infrastructure, they already have some asset creation for offering 5 trades. So, in case of those 5 trades, they can upgrade the equipment, they can get it repaired or some more equipment can be added. So, we are providing 20,000 rupees per extension center for the 5 old centers, and at the rate of 70,000 rupees for 5 additional center. So, 5 center multiplied by 70,000, that works out to 3.5 lakh, and 5 old center multiplied by 20,000 rupees, another 1 lakh rupees, that is how it works out to 4.5 lakh. Now, tools and equipment at main center. So, equipment, tools and equipment worth 3 lakh rupees can be purchased by first timer, new institutions, and tools and equipment worth rupees 2 lakh can be purchased by the old institutes. Then there is an important activity under the scheme, popularizing technology or transfer of technology. For undertaking this activity, we again have provision for purchase of technology items required for demonstration and fabrication. So, new institutions will get 2 lakh rupees, old institution will get 1.3 lakh rupees. Then creation of infrastructure, furniture and other physical facilities, you can well imagine what all is required in teaching learning. So, basic, for building up this basic infrastructure, new institutions are provided 6 lakh rupees each, and old institution will receive 3.9 lakh rupees. These institutions are also provided one time grant for building up instructional resources, projection system and software, etcetera. So, new institutions will get 2 lakh rupees for that purpose, and old institution will get 1.3 lakh. And under this head, there are two subheads. First head is print material, which will include books, journals, magazines, posters, etcetera, and non-print material, which may include video films, clippings, etcetera. So, this is one head, and the other head pertains to software for management information system or geographical information system, etcetera, and data, basically for database management. So, we have intentionally not prescribed the outcome here. It is a flexibility provided to the principal depending upon the need of that institution. So, accordingly these 2 lakh rupees can be apportioned. Now, the heads under which a recurring grant is to be utilized, we have already talked about non-recurring grant. Now, each institution is going to get 17 lakh rupees as the recurring grant. So, I would like to deliberate upon as to how these 17 lakh rupees are to be utilized. So, here the first very major head of expenditure is honorarium. Total honorarium bill, including functionaries engaged at extension center, all staff will be purely on contractual basis under in a project mode. So, 11.68 lakh rupees. So, at the maximum 11.68 lakh rupees can be spent on payment of wages, salaries, honorarium, etcetera. Then 2 lakh rupees have been earmarked for training contingency. This training contingency is nothing but when you offer a skill program, naturally some material is required. So this training contingency is basically for purchase of material. Student need to carry on practice. Okay. So including raw material, consumable, rent of extension center, etc., rent of the premises if required, and if required even the water and electricity bill can be paid out of that. So 2 lakh rupees is provided for that. Then third head of expenditure is technology demonstration. Under technology demonstration, a polytechnic can spend 1 lakh rupees per annum. So technology demonstration, technology transfer, technical services camp, exhibition, extension lecture by expert, reputed scientist, environmentalist, social activist, health expert. So they can be invited, they can deliver lecture on different aspects. And then scheme related final year students can also be involved if the polytechnic so desire. So they can involve their final year students in scheme related activities, and in case there is some direct expenditure involved in that, so that can be met out of the, this scheme, but it has to fit in under this particular head. Hiring of vehicle from outside agencies / fuel and maintenance charges of vehicle. You see, under the earlier scheme, some of the polytechnics, they were provided vehicles. Many polytechnic, they had purchased 4-wheeler. So those polytechnic which had vehicle and that vehicle was found to be in running condition, so they have been provided a budget of 72,000 rupees, and this 72,000 rupees will take care of their fuel, maintenance charges, etc. And those institutions which do not have any vehicle, so same amount, equivalent amount that has been provided for hiring or outsourcing of vehicle. Because time to time the polytechnic need to inspect the extension center. They may even have to transfer material from one center to another, so transportation charges, traveling, etc. So all those expenses they get booked under this head, and 72,000 rupees is provided for that. Then maintenance of equipment and infrastructure at extension center at the rate of 6,000 rupees per extension center. See, infrastructure once built up, now this infrastructure would definitely require some repair, maintenance or upkeep. So for that matter, 6,000 rupees per extension center is provided under the scheme. So total works out to 60,000 rupees in a year. Then travelling charges. These travelling charges are basically for the chief coordinator or internal coordinator and project staff. In case they need to come to NITO Chandigarh or go to some other place, so they will draw their TADA, etc. under this head. Then finally, other project related expenses and office contingencies. This could include expenses on conducting socio-economic survey, then review and case studies, photocopying, photography, stationery, postage, advertisement in local newspaper, insurance charges for tools and equipment, etc. So this total expenditure must not exceed 50,000, and if you add all them together, so total would work out to 17 lakh. So if a polytechnic can utilize this 17 lakh rupees in a year and can impart training to 600 persons and also meets the target as prescribed under technology transfer and organizing technical and support services, so in that case the polytechnic would definitely be reimbursed 17 lakh rupees over a period of 1 year. Now I would like to tell you what all honorarium etc. is payable. See, nobody is going to work without getting some money. Some incentive has to be inbuilt. So here, people who are going to contribute to this scheme, implementation of this scheme, they are going to be given little incentive. This incentive is going to be in the form of honorarium. So first of all, principal or director of the institute who assumes the responsibility of the chief coordinator, so this person is going to be paid 3,000 rupees per month, and we need just one coordinator in one institution. So principal gets 3,000 rupees, and then thereafter one of the senior head of the department, but here seniority is not the criteria. Okay, any person whom the principal feel, okay, this person is going to carry on this activity effectively. So that person can be designated as internal coordinator, and internal coordinator will receive monthly honorarium of 2,000 rupees. Then some of the head of the departments, they may be involved in supervising the training program. So here at the maximum 5 head of the department, they can be involved in supervising the program, and for each program completed, head of the department is going to receive 1000 rupees as the honorarium. This amount is very negligible, I would say. Then wherever you have post of administrative officer or superintendent or deputy superintendent, so one of these 3 person is going to be paid at the rate of 600 rupees per month. And in case there is an accountant in the institute, so accountant gets 500 rupees per month, cashier will get another 400 rupees, and this storekeeper who is going to issue material from time to time, and this person is going to facilitate purchases, storage of material, etc. So this person also gets 400 rupees per month. So these were the rates of honorarium. Now we come to the contractual staff. So I have told you, if somebody from within the polytechnic is going to be involved, they will get little incentive in the form of honorarium. And as regards the contractual staff, one of you asked me a very relevant question, if probably the scheme is going to put a lot of burden on the polytechnic. No, it is not that. In fact, this scheme can help you mobilize support, and you will have many functionaries working in the polytechnic. So you can get the polytechnic work done, you can get the scheme related work done from these people. So here, first of all, the polytechnic has to necessarily appoint one person as community development consultant. This community development consultant is going to work with the polytechnic under this scheme on full time basis, and this person would be paid at the rate of 10,000 rupees per month. This is the consolidated honorarium. Then you can have services of a junior consultant for extension service center. There are going to be 5 to 10 extension center in each polytechnic. They need to be supervised. So this junior consultant is the one who will assume charge and who will visit these centers from time to time. Then there are going to be guest trainers. We do not say this thing, okay, you conduct program only with the help of your own workshop staff or your own trainers or your instructors. Under this scheme, if the polytechnic so desires, they may or may not involve their own internal staff. Suppose they do not want to involve their own internal staff, instructor, etc. So they can recruit trainers, guest trainer. We have designated them as guest trainers as per actual requirement, and this actual requirement could be at the maximum 20%. We are suggesting 5 to 10 extension center, and we expect at least 2 trades to be offered at each extension center. That means you need 2 trainers. So if there are maximum 10 extension center, there could be at the maximum 20 trainers. So these 20 trainers, they can be recruited on contractual basis. Okay. Then there is a position of junior statistical consultant. This junior statistical consultant is nothing but a dignified clerk. So this person will attend to jobs like data entry, operator, then record keeping, maintaining files, and then keeping track of the students. So junior, there is a position of junior statistical consultant on contractual basis, and this person is also going to be paid at the rate of 6,000 rupees per month. There is a position of driver, but this position hold good only in case of institution where there are vehicles. So wherever there is a vehicle available, so there the institution can appoint, they can engage the services of a driver, and this driver is also going to be paid at the rate of 6,000 rupees per month. But the post of driver, slowly and slowly this position of driver is to be abolished. Earlier scheme was operational for about 27 years. Vehicles were purchased sometime either in 1980s or 1990s. So most of these vehicles have become unserviceable now, or if at all they are maintained, they cost quite a lot. So we suggest to Polytechnic that all these vehicles, they need to be phased out in a phased manner, and once the vehicle are phased out, then the position of driver is also gone. So then the institution will not receive remuneration on account of honorarium to be to the driver. Okay. There is a note given over here, the above cost to government is inclusive of employees and employer share of provident fund as applicable, which may be deducted before making payment. In some of the states, see, these are all contractual positions and they are not going to exist for more than a year, but some of the employees, they expect that their provident fund need to be deducted. So in case they insist on deduction of this thing, provident fund, etc., so this amount of provident fund, that has to be deducted out of the remuneration mentioned over here, nothing over and above the prescribed limit. So that is the maximum budget going to be available with the Polytechnic. Then we come to as to how institution need to go about appointing these project staff. So appointment of has to be purely on contractual basis. The selected Polytechnics are authorized to engage the following project staff on contractual basis. So here the very first staff is community development consultant, and this person is to be paid at the rate of 10,000 rupees. Then junior consultant for extension center, this person is going to be paid 6,000 rupees consolidated honorarium. Then guest trainers, 10 to 20 in number, it could be any number in the range of 10 to 20 or could be even less than 10, because there is a provision of even engaging you know, staff from your own Polytechnic, and they can also be paid some honorarium. Okay. So each extension center is required to offer minimum 2 trades. Junior consultant to be paid at the rate of 6,000 rupees and driver at the rate of 6,000. Now with regard to appointment of this project staff, Government of India has prescribed a format, a standard appointment letter. In fact, this standard appointment letter, again this letter is available in this booklet. Format of that appointment offer is given in this booklet, and all formalities need to be completed. Affidavit has to be got signed from the employee, and all project staff to be engaged strictly on contractual basis. There is no permanent staff. So all project staff to be engaged on strictly on contractual basis after completing necessary legal formalities on prescribed forms provided by the Government of India, and those forms are available in this booklet. Now I will discuss with you the qualification laid down for different positions. So we first come to qualification for the post of community development consultant. This community development consultant could be second class master's degree in social works or rural development, agriculture, agriculture extension, or any other branch of social sciences. This is one set of qualification. Or alternatively, it could be second class diploma in any branch of engineering / technology with 2 years experience in community development / rural development related work. In fact, we go much beyond that. Even a retired person from Polytechnic, a seasoned head of the department, the one who is willing to contribute to community services, even that sort of person can be inducted as a community development consultant. Now qualification for the post of junior consultant. Junior consultant will have the qualification like minimum second class diploma in any branch of engineering or technology. This is one set of qualification. Alternatively, second class bachelor's degree in any discipline with 1 year's experience in industry / rural development. So this is the qualification prescribed for junior consultant. Now as I referred to earlier, you can appoint 10 to 20 guest trainers. These guest trainers are nothing but instructors, the people who are going to impart the skill training. So their qualification is given here. Person should possess the competency / skills required for imparting training program in the concerned field, jis field ke liye aap chun rahe hain usko. So this person should be capable of imparting training in that field and should be ITI pass or should have undergone training program from some recognized institute under the state oblique central government or under the scheme of CDTP. There are certain trades which are not available in ITI, which are not offered by state government or central government. So, in that case, a person who has undergone a particular skill training program under the scheme of community development through Polytechnic, so this person is eligible to become trainer for that particular trade or any program which is considered equivalent to these programs. So, these are the qualifications prescribed for the post of guest trainers. Then qualification for the post of junior statistical consultant. This person is basically largely going to work as going to provide clerical support. So, this person could be second class bachelor's degree in any discipline with 1 year's experience in industry oblique rural development oblique community development work. The junior statistical consultant appointed on contractual basis under CDTP scheme would also attend to the work pertaining to other centrally sponsored scheme. There is a scheme called Integrating Persons with Disability in Mainstream of Technical and Vocational Education. So, wherever this scheme exists, so this person who is appointed as junior statistical consultant under CDTP scheme would also attend to the work pertaining to the scheme referred to here or any other centrally sponsored scheme. Because Government of India is not going to provide secretarial support or clerical support under each scheme. So, there may be one or more than one schemes operational in a polytechnic. So, entire burden pertaining to secretarial work, so that burden goes to this person who is designated as junior statistical consultant. Then regarding selection of the project staff. Selection of the project staff shall be the sole responsibility of the Polytechnic and the State Directorate of Technical Education of the concerned states or union territory. Respective states of the union territories shall evolve their own criteria for selection of project staff. Staff required at various levels shall be taken from the teaching and supporting staff. Now, I am talking about the staff which is to be taken from within the Polytechnic. Okay. So, staff required at various levels shall be taken from teaching and supporting staff of the Polytechnic from amongst the willing member. However, while selecting the staff, it should be ensured that they possess the competencies required for instructional and extension services, extension activities. In order that adequate number of people are available for this work, planned staff development programs are to be taken up too. The selection of internal part-time staff shall be made by the principal or director of the Polytechnic. The principal may form a dynamic team of faculty members to run the activity without any bias of caste, gender, creed or religion. So, these are the considerations while appointing the staff, project staff within the Polytechnic or project staff on contractual basis. So, I have discussed with you the details about the scheme, what this scheme is all about, how do people apply under this scheme, how the applications are scrutinized, how the monitoring takes place, what sort of funding is available under this scheme, how much recurring, how much non-recurring, how the funds are to be utilized. I have also discussed with you about the qualification, recruitment, etcetera of the project staff. Okay. Now, in case you have any questions pertaining to this particular scheme, so I will be too glad to answer your queries. In case any one of you later on have any query and you want to get enlightened about that, so here are the addresses of the faculty given. There are four faculty members in my department. I am Dr. J. S. Saini. My email address and other telephonic contact, etcetera, they are given. Then next to me, there is Mrs. Poonam Sial, who is associate professor in the Department of Rural Development. Her contact details are given here. Then we have Dr. U. N. Roy, another associate professor, and Mr. Amit Goyal. So we are 4 faculty member in the department. Our contact details are given over here. So in case you need any additional information, any clarification about this scheme, so you can contact us through telephone or through email or as you wish. So this was about the scheme of community development through Polytechnic.